So I'm building a machine to scan some 8mm family films from the 1970s. It captures each frame a few times with different color light. The first thing you notice when you get something like this up and running is that it's basically a microscope connected to some motors. I'm using a 2K camera, which translates to each pixel recording an area smaller than 3 microns on a side. So the slightest vibration, just shifting in your chair or standing up, shakes everything and can ruin a capture. At its current speed, scanning a 3-minute reel takes hours. Trying not to move that whole time so you don't ruin any frames is, well, stressful. And with kids running around, even when they're on the other side of the house, it is just impossible. I could let it run overnight, but these are precious family heirlooms, so I'd rather not leave them unattended in my random homemade machine. So, if we can't avoid vibration, what if the machine could detect it? If we had a sensor that picked up the shaking, the scanner could check after each frame and repeat the capture. Then you could scan film anytime. Any movement would add a second or two, but the machine could carry on normally and your results would still be good. I started searching around to see if anyone else had already made something like this and found this nice series of videos by David Holding from 2014. Between the videos and a couple blog posts, David explains how you can use a piezo element to make a high-sensitivity vibration sensor for just a few dollars in parts. My eventual solution is based closely on his design, but I thought it'd be fun to walk through the circuit and a few of my changes in a little more detail. The key to the whole thing is one of these piezo discs. This one is 35mm, and you can get 15 of them online for $5. The disc is just a little slice of special material sandwiched between two metal plates. For our purposes, when you squeeze the sandwich, the piezoelectric effect produces a voltage that you can measure on the plates. If we take a look at the raw output from tapping one of these, the first thing you notice is that the signal floats all over the place. Even when you stop, it can take a little while to return to 0 volts. Let's see if it can hold a voltage. If we put a fixed weight on the plates, it still recovers a couple seconds later. This is just an open circuit, so we know there's a little internal current leakage between the plates. That's all right, though. Since we're only interested in voltage changes, we want this centered on zero most of the time. So let's help it stay centered by giving it an easier current return path by adding a resistor in parallel. If the internal resistance of the disc is a few megaohms, letting it pass through a 100K resistor should drain off the tiny bits of charge much faster. If you squint a little, this almost looks like an RC high-pass filter. It behaves like one too. Getting rid of the slow, sub-1Hz part of the signal is a good start. Next, it'll be helpful to learn how much voltage this thing can produce. The plan is to package this up as a sensor that can be read from an Arduino, Raspberry Pi, or other low-voltage system, so it's important that we're not exceeding the limits on the input pins of anything else in the circuit. I've got this meter set to show maximum readings. Just poking at the disc with a finger, it's easy to get above 10 volts, but where's the limit? What happens when I accidentally drop the final sensor on the floor? Well, let's simulate it and find out. I've seen as high as 70 volts this way. We'll need to be careful with that. Tackling this problem would normally take more thought, but there's a nice workaround in our case. The key insight is that we never care about these big peaks. The tiny rumbling that we're hoping to detect will always be down here, so we can solve the peak voltage problem with a blunt instrument, plain diodes. As soon as the potential goes above 0.7 volts, the diode conducts, the charge takes the easiest path to the other disc, and the voltage doesn't go any higher. That lops those big peaks right off. Use another diode in the opposite direction, and you drop the negative peaks too. Now, if we drop this thing on the ground, we don't have to worry about destroying any components further downstream. The last bit of signal conditioning I'd like to do before we start amplifying things is a simple RC low-pass filter with a cutoff below 2 kHz. This'll clean up anything weird that the wires or piezo element pick up. Anything that can shake a desk will be oscillating slower than that. We've got a nice signal now, but even if we zoom in, we're still not seeing much when the desk shakes. This was the brilliant part from David's videos. If you couple the disc with the surface it's on, it becomes much more sensitive. And that's as easy as using a weight to hold it down against the table. One mechanical detail. These little discs usually have a pair of soldered wires. It can be tricky to distribute weight evenly across the top plate, without hitting that metal bump, or worse, if your weight is conductive, you can accidentally short both plates together. My weight is larger than the entire top plate, so I 3D printed this pedestal that has a little cutout for the solder bump. With this in place, it's a lot easier to apply the force uniformly. Once the disc is coupled to a surface, it picks up everything. This is like the old trick of putting your ear to a railroad track to hear the train that's miles away. Now we're in good shape. We've got a signal that hangs out around zero, has had any stray high-frequency noise cleaned up, and actually picks up the kind of events we're interested in. Now we just have to make it loud enough for our microcontroller to hear it. The obvious choice is an op amp in a vanilla non-inverting configuration. That'll multiply the input voltage by some factor we pick, but the cost is that op amps need power. To amplify a signal like ours that's centered around 0 volts, you usually need a split power supply with a positive and negative rail. It can be a little tedious if the types of systems you're connecting to only offer positive voltage supplies. That's the boat we're in. Raspberry Pi and Arduino offer 3.3 or 5 volt lines, but no negative voltages. The good news is that there's another easy workaround. We don't really care about the negative half of the signal. As long as we get something when the desk shakes, we're good. So we can choose a single supply op amp, even if it means losing the negative half of the signal. Powering it becomes easy, and even with just the positive half of the signal, we still get what we want. Now, how much gain do we want? The short answer is that we don't know. Each of these piezo elements is going to behave differently, and each desk is a little more or less wobbly. So this is the one place we'll need a knob we can adjust. In this configuration, this potentiometer will give us a nice wide range for our gain, but the signal response won't be linear. This is another easy one to fix. If we use a pot with a log response, our gain curve will be mostly linear again. Now we can adjust our gain until even the tiniest vibrations are magnified enough for our microcontroller to notice. Before we go any further, there are a couple real-world things we have to deal with first. Before this is all over, we're going to need to pick a real part made by some real manufacturer that has real-world limits. One of the absolute maximum ratings you'll find on an op amp's datasheet is how far beyond the supply rails you're allowed to go. We'd like the convenience of using a single supply, which means our VSS rail will be ground, but our input signal from the piezo element goes below ground. It's not that far below, because of the diodes, but real-world op amps don't like inputs that go beyond their supply rails. If you check lots of datasheets, a typical rating is half a volt above or below your supplies. That's close, but our diodes only prevent voltages beyond 0.7 volts. We'd be a little out of spec if we used any parts like these. This isn't an easy one to search for. Finding a part with a wider tolerance than that came down to spot checking datasheets until I found this one that allows 1 volt above and below. That's good enough for us, but there's a note attached to that line. And that note leads to another note. And there, we learn that going below ground can actually source current from the input pins. That's not great. The answer, if you're expecting your input to go below ground, is to just add a resistor to each input. That works for us and doesn't throw any wrenches into any gears, but this exercise is a useful reminder that real-world parts have all these warts that you don't normally have to deal with in simulators. Alright, we're in the home stretch. We've got a nice signal, and now we can make it loud without burning out our amplifier. We could connect this directly to our Arduino or whatever, but this is still a very analog-type signal, and our microcontrollers like nice, clean, fast digital edges. I messed around for a while with a 555 timer to see if I couldn't get it to generate a nice pulse whenever this wavy line went above a certain threshold. This is the monostable mode of the 555. The problem was, during bigger or longer lasting shakes, it would run past the end of the pulse and keep turning on for another full cycle. Ideally, we want our sensor's output to stay on just until the shaking stops. But with a 555, you get these intermittent pulses where the timer keeps firing over and over. Poking around at the parts website again, I spotted some chips in the 555's category that were labeled as re-triggerable. That is what we want. So long as the input keeps ringing, the timer on the clean digital pulse will keep starting over, so the pulse can continue as long as it needs to. With that, we've got everything we need. We're taming this messy analog signal and transforming it into a nice, clean digital pulse. There's just one final consideration. How do we want to interact with this sensor? If we stop right here, we've got a 5-volt signal whenever shaking is detected. That's fine for most Arduino models, but it's not fine for Raspberry Pi or a lot of other devices with inputs that can only handle 3.3 volts. A great solution here would be something that didn't depend on the supply voltage. And that's exactly what we get if we make this an open drain output. It just takes one extra transistor. Now, instead of providing a voltage directly, the sensor is just opening or closing a kind of valve. If one side of that valve is connected to ground, then when the sensor fires and the valve opens, whatever pressure might have built up is released and the output pin is pulled to ground. When the valve is closed, the impedance becomes so high, the output might as well be a disconnected wire. The way to read from an open drain output is by bringing your own voltage behind a pull-up resistor. When the valve is closed, you see your voltage. When the valve opens, the pressure is released and that pin sees ground. This is perfect because you can't go over a data pin's max voltage if the microcontroller is the one supplying that voltage. So this works with just about anything. Best of all, virtually all microcontrollers have built-in pull-ups that you enable with code. So connecting this thing to the rest of your system only takes a single wire with no extra components. I'll add a final resistor here as a cheesy current limit just in case I short the input to my supply rail somehow, but that's it. We're done. Oh, wait. It'd also be nice if we could see when this thing was firing. That'll give us some feedback when adjusting the sensitivity. Let's add an LED. All right. Now we're done. With the first stage. Now that we've got a circuit design, we need to build it. There's so little going on here that it would have been nice to use through-hole parts. That would have made it easier to test initially and to assemble later. But the two main components that drive this thing are surface mount only. I could have ordered the parts first and put them on those breadboard-friendly adapter boards for testing, but I was in kind of a hurry. So instead, I decided to hope for the best, order the PCBs, and cross my fingers that it worked on the first try. That kind of impatience is often rewarded with extra debugging on the final board. So I pulled out a few of the most interesting lines as test points that would be easy to connect to a scope probe. In the past, I've done early testing on a PCB without these, and it wasn't any fun. This was the first time I'd remembered to add test points, and it ended up working great. One rule I try to live by is to always use through-hole parts for anything I'm going to be yanking on, like ports, buttons, and potentiometers. I've had surface mount connectors crack off in the past, tearing traces off the board in the process, so I try to keep that lesson in mind. For the main connector on this board, the only external lines we have are 5 volts, ground, and the output pin. This thing uses almost no power, and our signal frequency might as well be DC, so we could choose just about any connector. Sticking with standard ports makes it easier to find wires or adapters later, so I settled on one of those tiny TRS jacks they use for phone headsets. The piezo disc doesn't technically need a connector. You could just solder the leads directly to the board, but I like the idea of being able to take this apart later if something breaks. So I chose one of those little Molex Pico blade connectors you can see sometimes on tiny computer fans. But just in case someone out there also wants to build one of these, but doesn't want to go through the trouble of crimping tiny pins, there are a couple standard pin header holes on the PCB that you can use instead. Use header pins or solder the disc right to the board. It's up to you. I liked the idea of keeping it flexible in the same way that the open drain output lets you connect this to just about anything. That's it for board layout. It's still a little magical to me that I can click a button on my computer and a couple business days later hold the real thing in my hand. While I was waiting, I made this little assembly map. If I'm only making one or two boards, something like this comes in handy for keeping my tiny SMD parts organized. All right, let's make one. Hand-soldered the through-hole parts off-camera, so here's the board complete. Let's connect the piezo element, put a pull-up resistor on the output, clip a scope probe onto each one of these test points, and power it up. just lovely. That's everything behaving just as we expected. This looks great. The journey is almost complete. The last thing we need is to make this self-contained. Let's design a little enclosure to hold everything together. For the official weight, I picked one of these 200-gram calibration weights. Not because we need the precision, but because they come in a standard form factor and are only a couple dollars online. The case design is pretty bare bones. It's just enough to mount the PCB and retain the weight in the center of the disc. The goal was something that was easy to 3D print without supports, so there are a couple features like these standoffs that taper down instead of jutting straight out. For mounting, it just uses standard M2 hardware that you can press into the holes. Here's the finished print. I actually went through a couple revisions before I remembered that the disc needed an insertion path. It's still a little bit of a puzzle box getting it in there, but this works all right. A little super glue holds the pedestal to the disc. A little more glue mounts the disc in the case. Add a few bolts to fasten the board. Connect the disc, and it's ready to go. Beyond serving a useful purpose, this thing makes a great desk toy. With the sensitivity cranked up, you notice all these little motions that shake the room more than you would have expected. I've got some example code on the project's GitHub that shows how the output pin might trigger an interrupt on an Arduino. Because we took care when designing the hardware interface, it only takes a few lines to do something useful with it in the software. So that's it. Now my film scanner works, despite my children's best efforts. If you want to make one of these for yourself, I've got all the parts lists, PCB files, and STLs on the project page. Be sure to check it out. Thanks for watching.